बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। अस्सलामु अलैकुम। आई एम डॉक्टर मोहम्मद सलीम इकबाल, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर ऑफ सर्जरी, डिप्टी कंट्रोलर ऑफ एग्जामिनेशन, फैसलाबाद मेडिकल यूनिवर्सिटी फैसलाबाद, सर्टिफाइड इन मेडिकल टीचिंग। टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस अनदर इम्पॉर्टेंट टॉपिक, दैट इज मिनिमल असेस सर्जरी नोट्स, दैट इज नेचुरल ओरिफिसेस ट्रांस एंडोल्यूमिनल सर्जरी एंड रोबोटिक सर्जरी। बट बिफोर आई स्टार्ट डिस्कशन, आई रिक्वेस्ट यू ऑल प्लीज सब्सक्राइब माई चैनल एंड प्रेस बेल आइकॉन। आई डेडिकेट दिस लेक्चर टू माई मेंटर प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर जफर अली चौधरी, वाइस चांसलर फैसलाबाद मेडिकल यूनिवर्सिटी फैसलाबाद, हु इज़ अ कंटिन्यूस सोर्स ऑफ इनकरेजमेंट एंड मोटिवेशन फॉर मी। ब्रीफ ओवरव्यू ऑफ माई टूडेज लेक्चर इज मिनिमल इन्वेजिव सर्जरी, डोमेन्स ऑफ मिनिमल इन्वेजिव सर्जरी, डिफरेंस ऑफ मिनिमल इन्वेजिव सर्जरी फ्रॉम ओपन सर्जरी, advantages of minimal invasive surgery, disadvantages of minimal invasive surgery, current practices, then laparoscopic surgery, single incision laparoscopic surgery, complications of laparoscopic surgery, contraindications, different ways of pneumoperitoneums, gasless laparoscopic surgery, natural orifices trans endoluminal surgery and overview of robots. What is minimal invasive surgery? Minimal invasive surgery is the operation performed through minimal possible physical, physiological and psychological trauma, or minimal invasive surgery is defined as one that is carried out by entering the body through skin or through a body cavity or anatomical opening, but with the smallest damage possible to the structures. So you should be with me throughout the lectures to have a great concept about minimal invasive surgery. I will proceed with saying of crack map. If you can film an idea in your mind, follow that film idea shot for shot, scene for scene. That idea is worth making. Principal differences between laparoscopic and open surgery. For the patients, post operative pain related to size of incision, because minimal invasive surgery has smaller incision, so patient will have less pain post operatively. Less handling of intestine in minimal invasive surgery results in little or no disturbance of normal function of bowel. Avoidance of trauma of abdominal wall by smaller incision allows rapid return to normal activity, and no incision allows early return to more strenuous activities, driving, lifting, sports, etc. For the hospital, initial capital cost to establish laparoscopic surgery is more than conventional surgery, but there is a reduced overall cost due to shortening of hospital stay. For example, in laparoscopic cholecystectomy, time for stay in hospital is reduced from 2 to 3 days to 1 day. Differences between laparoscopic and open surgery for the surgeons are as follows. Magnified view, often better than obtained via an incision, allows precise dissection. Altered but not absent tactile response. Two-dimensional view, usually but not always, longer operating time. Need to develop entirely different operating techniques. Adaptation of principles of open surgery to laparoscopic surgery. What are advantages of minimal invasive surgery. I will divide advantages into three main categories: benefits to patient, benefits to surgeon, and hospital benefits. Patient benefits are smaller fever or absent scar. Second is the less post-operative pain and disability, reduced time in hospital and earlier return to full activity, decreased wound-related complications. Benefits to surgeons are reduced post-operative stay of patient, possible avoidance of the need for interventional anesthetic techniques such as epidurals, improved visualization of operative field, decreased contact with pathogens for surgical team. Hospital benefits are reduced post-operative complications that ultimately reduce hospital stay and improve cost effectiveness. And second benefit is use of video records aid communication with patients and their families. Now, what are disadvantages of minimal invasive surgery? Cumbersome instruments that are smaller in diameter and they are to be inserted at fixed angle through the abdominal wall. The use of suction is limited by the need for constant pneumoperitoneum in order to see operative field. Tactile sensation is lost. This is the single biggest disadvantage of laparoscopy. The inability to place a hand in the abdomen and feel tissue makes it very difficult to locate masses and find correct tissue planes. It also decreases the safety of blunt dissection and increases operative time. The next is longer procedure time, especially on the initial slope of surgical learning curve. Next disadvantage is depth perception is diminished. That is, the use of television monitor makes laparoscopy two-dimensional. Tasks requiring fine motor skills such as sewing and dissection around major blood vessels are more difficult than during laparotomy. Next is hemostasis. Hemostasis is very difficult in laparoscopic surgery. Intraoperative bleeding during laparoscopy is harder to manage due to two reasons. One is sudden severe hemorrhage is nearly impossible to control as hand cannot be used to tamponade bleeding and ability to suction is limited. Second, limited means are available to manage constant low level bleeding that may occur in patients that are taking anticoagulant therapy or on aspirin. Next disadvantage is suturing. Suturing is very difficult in case of minimally invasive surgery. Several factors make laparoscopic suturing difficult and time consuming than suturing during open surgery. These factors include fixed angles of instrument insertion, long cumbersome needle holders, loss of depth perception, and need for a cooperative camera holder. Next disadvantage is that laparoscopy is resource intensive. What it means, compared with laparotomy, laparoscopy requires relatively delicate and expensive equipments that require more knowledge and sophistication on the part of operating room staff to operate and maintain. Then other disadvantage is cost effectiveness. Cost effectiveness of laparoscopy is uncertain. In general, laparoscopic procedure use more expensive instruments and supplies and more disposable instrumentation than open surgery. The cost increase is amplified by longer operating time that is seen during surgeon's learning curve. Practices in minimal invasive surgery. These are cholecystectomy, appendectomy, hernia repair, colectomy, splenectomy, adenalectomy, Heller's myotomy, नाइसेंट फंडोप्लाइकेशन, इसोफेजेक्टमी, गैस्ट्रेक्टमी, पेंक्रियाटेक्टमी, बाइल डक्ट एक्सप्लोरेशन, बैरियाट्रिक सर्जरी, लिम्फ नोड्स बायोप्सी, एंड आई मस्ट से दैट ऑलमोस्ट एनीथिंग कैन बी डन विद मिनिमल इन्वेजिव सर्जरी. वट इज सिंगल इंसिजन लेप्रोस्कोपिक सर्जरी, दैट इज सिल्स. इट इज़ अ न्यू टेक्निक दैट हैज नो बिन यूटिलाइज इन मैनी सेंटर्स फॉर मिनिमल एसेस सर्जरी. मेजर डिफिकल्टी विद दिस टेक्निक इज दैट इट सेक्रीफाइजेस हैज टू बी मेड इन टर्म्स ऑफ कम्फर्ट एंड अर्गोनॉमिक्स. वन ऑफ द ग्रेट एडवांटेज ऑफ सिल इज दैट पेशेंट्स आर वेरी सेटिस्फाइड विद देयर सिंगल स्कार एंड पार्टिकुलरली एंथुसियास्टिक इन रिगार्ड टू द कॉस्मेटिक आउटकम. ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड सिंगल इंसिजन लेप्रोस्कोपिक सर्जरी इज कॉल्ड बाय फॉलोइंग टर्म्स दैट आर SPL सिंगल पोर्ट लेप्रोस्कोपिक सर्जरी, SPA सिंगल पोर्ट असेस सर्जरी, SILS सिंगल इंसिजन लेप्रोस्कोपिक सर्जरी, LESS लेप्रो एंडोस्कोपिक सिंगल साइट सर्जरी, OPUS वन पोर्ट अम्बिलिकल सर्जरी, NOTUS NOTUS दैट इज नेचुरल ओरिफिस ट्रांस अम्बिलिकस एंडोस्कोपिक सर्जरी. What are advantages of SILS? SILS offer improved cosmesis, ease of tissue retrieval, patient acceptance, early recovery, improved quality of life. Disadvantages of SILS: more pain as compared to laparoscopic surgery, violating principles of ergonomics, incisional hernia chances are more as compared to conventional laparoscopic surgery, more wound infection compared to conventional surgery, bigger learning curve compared to conventional laparoscopic surgery, and it is not cost effective as compared to conventional laparoscopic surgery. These are snapshots taken during cholecystectomy. On left side, this is the snapshot showing gallbladder. On right side, snapshot showing that cystic duct has been dissected out and clips are being applied on cystic duct. These are snapshots taken during Nissen's fundoplication. Snapshots showing laparoscopic appendectomy. Complications of minimally invasive surgery. General complications: overall mortality rate and incidence of major complications after laparoscopic procedure is similar to that seen in open procedures. Then there are complications of anesthesia, complications specific to laparoscopic surgery. These can be discussed under different headings that are complications due to needle or operating port insertion. Needle or operating port insertion can cause injury to abdominal wall vessels or nerve. Abdominal wall hematoma may occur as well. Then complications due to pneumoperitoneum. Pneumoperitoneum can cause ventilation changes that leads to decrease in compliance, decreased functional residual capacity. Cardiovascular changes, decreased venous return and cardiac output. Bradycardia is the most common arrhythmia during pneumoperitoneum. Respiratory changes, subcutaneous emphysema, pneumothorax, pneumomediastinum, gas embolism. Then renal changes, decrease in renal plasma flow, glomerular filtration rate and urine output. Hypercoagulable state, pneumoperitoneum and reversed Anti-Lambert's position that is used both increase venous stasis in lower limb, and it is more common in old age patients. Then stress and endocrine responses. Cortisol is elevated more in laparoscopy than open surgery. However, stress induced changes such as cytokine elevation, leukocytosis, hyperglycemia, immune system changes, these are less in laparoscopic surgery as compared to open surgery. Then abdominal wall hernia. Abdominal wall hernia may occur through 10 mm or larger trocar sites, and they usually occur at the site of umbilicus. Then complications due to laparoscopic instrumentation. These complications may be thermal or mechanical injury to underlying bowel, blood vessels or diaphragm. Visceral injuries may also occur due to excessive traction. What are surgical principles for laparoscopic surgery? Meticulous care in creation of pneumoperitoneum, controlled dissection of adhesions, adequate exposure of operative field, avoidance and control of bleeding, avoidance of organ injury, avoidance of diathermy damage, vigilance in post-operative period. Contraindications of minimally invasive surgery or laparoscopic surgery. I will divide contraindications into two main categories. These are absolute contraindications and relative contraindications. Absolute contraindications are inability to tolerate general anesthesia. However, minor procedures can be performed under regional or local anesthesia. Second is uncorrectable coagulopathy, frozen abdomen, intestinal obstruction with massive abdominal distension, hemorrhagic shock, severe cardiac dysfunction, major hemorrhage requiring life-saving procedures, for example, ruptured aortic aneurysm, concomitant disease requiring laparotomy. Relative contraindications may be untrained or inexperienced surgeon, inadequate equipment or instruments, assistant and time, abdominal sepsis, peritonitis, multiple previous abdominal operations, severe COPD, abdominal wall pathology, pregnancy and morbid obesity. Now about pneumoperitoneum. Pneumoperitoneum is insufflation of air inside the peritoneal cavity. It can be closed pneumoperitoneum or open pneumoperitoneum. Closed pneumoperitoneum is done with the help of varis needle. Now little about varis needle. Varis needle should be held like a dot. At the time of insertion, there should be 45 degree of elevation angle between instrument and body of patient. To get elevation angle of 45 degree, distal end of varus needle should be pointed towards anus. To prevent creation of preperitoneal slip of tip of varus needle, it is necessary that varus needle should be perpendicular to the abdominal wall. For lifting of abdominal wall, it should be held full thickness with the help of thenar, hypothenar and all four fingers. At the time of entry of varus needle, surgeon can hear and feel two click sounds. First click sound is due to rectus sheath and second sound is due to puncture of peritoneum. Once it is confirmed that varus needle is inside the abdominal cavity, insufflator is attached and flow is started. Now what are indicators of safe varus needle insertion? Number A is needle movement test. Once varus needle is inside the abdominal cavity, tip of varus needle should be free, and if surgeon moves it gently, there should be no feel of any resistance. Then second is irrigation test. A 10 ml syringe should be taken in one hand and surgeon should try to inject at least 5 ml of normal saline through varus needle. If tip of varis needle is inside the abdominal cavity, there will be free flow of saline inside the abdominal cavity. Otherwise, there will be a resistance if varis needle is outside the abdominal cavity. Next is aspiration test. After injecting saline, surgeon should try to aspirate saline back through varis needle, and if the needle is inside the abdominal cavity, no saline will be sucked. But if it is in preperitoneal space or in muscle fiber that is above the rectus, then injected water can be aspirated back. And in aspiration test, if more than irrigated fluid is coming out, then surgeon should suspect that patient is having either ascites, there is some cyst or perforation of urinary bladder. Next test is hanging drop test. Few drops of saline should be poured over the varis needle and abdominal wall should be lifted slightly. If tip of varis needle is inside the abdominal cavity, hanging drop should be sucked inside because there is a negative pressure. Next test is insufflation of gas test, that is quadromanometric test. For safe access, surgeon should always see carefully all the four indicators of insufflator at the time of creation of pneumoperitoneum. If the gas is flowing inside the abdominal cavity, there should be a proportionate rise in actual pressure with total gas used. Suppose only with the entry of 400 to 500 ml of gas, if actual pressure is equal to preset pressure of 12 mm, that means gas is not going in free abdominal cavity. Now about open pneumoperitoneum. In an effort to decrease the incidence of injuries associated with blind access to peritoneal cavity with varis needle and initial trocar, Hessen proposed a blunt open mini laparotomy access. He developed a reusable device of design that is similar to usual cannulas, but he attached an olive shaped cone, that is sleeve. This cannula is held in place by use of stay sutures passed through the facial edges and attached to the body of cannula. Nowadays, several disposable open access devices are available and they function similar to the previous used Hessen's cannula. Pneumoperitoneum in special conditions. For example, in scarred abdomen, insufflation through unscarred such as subcostal region, or if this is scarred, iliac fossa is better choice. A general guideline is to choose the quadrant of abdomen opposite to that of scar. Palmer's technique. A small incision is made to allow the insertion of varis needle through left subcostal margin. Because visceral parietal adhesions are rarely encountered in this area, so other is the obese patients. In obese patient, incision site should be transumbilical, that is base of umbilicus, because it has less fat even in obese persons. Once the varis needle is inside the abdominal cavity, peritoneal pressure should be created up to 14 to 18 mm, because normal abdominal pressure in non-obese individual is 5 mm or less, while in obese individual abdominal pressure is chronically elevated at 9 to 10 mm of mercury. Other special condition is diagnostic laparoscopy in unfit patients. In unfit patients, it can be performed under local anesthesia. Intravenous sedation should be given and pressure should not exceed 8 mm of mercury, otherwise patient will have pain. Why carbon dioxide is commonly used to create pneumoperitoneum. Carbon dioxide is commonly used to create pneumoperitoneum because it is readily available, it is cheaper, suppresses the combustion, easily absorbed by tissues, it has high diffusion coefficients, it is quickly released via respiration. Is it possible to perform laparoscopic surgery without creating pneumoperitoneum? Yes, it is possible by gasless laparoscopic surgery. In gasless laparoscopic surgery, abdominal lifting is done by mechanical devices which provide working place without creating pneumoperitoneum. With gasless techniques, conventional instruments can be used. Gasless laparoscopic surgery is primarily advocated for patients who are at high risk of pneumoperitoneum. A variety of abdominal lift devices has been developed recently to provide good working space. How tissue is retrieved after performing surgery? There are different techniques for retrieval of tissue. Common one is endobag retrieval. Tissue to be removed is first encased in a retrieval bag. Then morcillator. Use of morcillator is another way which facilitates grinding of solid tissue, and then these can be taken out without any difficulty. Other option is hand assisted laparoscopic surgery. Hand assisted technique was initially started keeping inside ease of tissue retrievals, wherein the surgeon uses his or her hand inserted through the initial incision and to aid in the exploration, isolation and removal of tissue. Next is colpotomy. For large size gynecological tissue, colpotomy route is good for retrieval. What are indications of diagnostic laparoscopy? Acute pelvic conditions, tubal pregnancy, ovarian diseases, infertility, staging for malignancy, biopsy from tumor, in chronic pain abdomen where ultrasound, endoscopies, barium studies are negative, then diagnostic laparoscopy is very useful option. Advantages of diagnostic laparoscopy are laparotomy is avoided, and once the diagnosis is made through diagnostic laparoscopy, therapeutic procedures can also be carried out in same sitting. Now a little bit about natural orifices, transluminal endoscopic surgery. This is a surgical technique whereby scarless abdominal operations can be performed with an endoscope passed through natural orifices, that is mouth, urethra, anus, vagina. Then through an internal incision in the stomach, vagina, bladder or colorectum, thus avoiding external incisions or scar. The transvaginal access to node seem to be the safest and feasible. With fever potential complications, the procedure has a disadvantage of being possible only in women. Advantages of node: lower anesthesia requirements, faster recovery and shorter hospital stay, avoidance of potential complications of wounds, less immunosuppression, better postoperative pulmonary and diaphragmatic functions, potential for scarless abdominal surgery. Disadvantages are: it is a single port surgery and difficulty in visualization of area in need from all directions, which is essential for proper surgical dissection. Poor maneuverability is the problem. Sepsis through this potentially infected area into sterile peritoneal cavity is a real risk. After procedure, non-closure of port site opening in these approach site, or if closing, their inadequacy are at
at real risk. In notes. Now, what are robots? A machine that resembles a human and does mechanical routine tasks on command. Any mechanical device that operates automatically with human-like skills. A robot is not a machine, it is an information system with arms. These are different descriptions about robot. But basically it is of two types, passive robot and active robot. Passive robots act as retractor systems and position the tool and then hold. Active robots would actively move the tool upon the surgeon command. What are components of robotic system? These are console where surgeon sits, binocular lenses create a three-dimensional image, a motion filtration system minimizes hand tremor, robot a mobile tower with four arms, bedside cart, camera and light source transmit images to console. Disadvantages of robots. These are expensive, machines are costly, annual maintenance, contracts should be revised and disposable instruments are to be used for this type of technique. There is steep surgical learning curve, increased staff training and competence, increased operation room setup or turnover time. Now what is call to action? Please watch this video again and again and share link on different WhatsApp groups. Practice minimal invasive surgery where possible. In my today's lecture, I have tried my level best to describe about minimally invasive surgery, laparoscopy, robots, then gasless laparoscopic surgery and various methods and techniques. I hope you have enjoyed my lecture. I prepare my lecture from book Surgical Tutor. In my next lecture, I will inshallah discuss about suture materials. I hope you have enjoyed my this lecture. Stay connected through my different links. Please share my video. Take care. Stay blessed. Allah Hafiz.